funny kind of thing, but right at the end of The Melting Pot, David is apparently, right in the performances in Broadway in 1908, is standing there with Vera by his side, the Statue of Liberty behind him, and he's singing about the future that the United States promises of being a place in which people can come and leave the old world behind and build a new future of humanity. It's a really beautiful vision. The way that this was implemented and applied in the United States was perhaps less so. In policies around the country, both state, local, and federal, the emphasis was on something called Americanization. The idea being that if you wanted to come to the United States and to be a person who stays here, you have to learn how to be an American. And part of that means giving up some of your cultural background and your part of your identity from the old world that you come from. So in order to be an American, you have to give up some things from your old life and embrace new values, new traditions, and of course, English. In a poll that was done by CNN in 2010-2011, people were asked, Americans, whereas, should immigrants have to give up parts of their identity in order to be considered Americans in this society? And in fact, a majority of Americans still believe that assimilation is the proper kind of thing to ask of immigrants. Meaning that if you want to come here, you should expect to have to forget, ignore, put away parts of your historical traditions in order to stay and remain here. What I've done in my book is I look at a group of philosophers in the beginnings of the 1920s or so who questioned this idea and asked, is it really ethical or moral for a democratic society to expect that immigrants give up parts of their identity in order to be accepted in a democratic society? And the answer that many of these figures that I look at is no, that we need to get rid of the melting pot. And at least what one of these authors, his name is Horace Kalin, says, we should adopt a new model for thinking about how a democratic society can work that's multiracial and multicultural. And he suggests getting rid of the melting pot and substituting the orchestra. Or we can put this in another way, a choir. What I've learned from one of my brightest graduate students, right? She gave me this sort of metaphor. The choir is a much sort of better image to think about this, right? The choir works not because all of the voices sing in the same voice. So you have baritone, soprano, bass, alto, right? Typically in a well-functioning choir, they all have their own parts and their own voices. And it makes music because of the harmony of differences between their voices. Horace Kalin suggested this should be the model for thinking about how to build a multicultural society. Don't force everyone to speak or sing in the same voice. Allow people to have their own voices, to experience their own ways of life here, but build a harmony rather than a unison. And in one editorial that I wrote about this, President Trump thinks that beautiful music can only happen if everyone sings in a baritone voice. And that would be a particularly aesthetically unpleasant kind of world in which that was the only kind of musical voice we could listen to. So the model becomes something different. And I look at other figures who go even beyond that, who say, yeah, not only should we allow immigrants to flourish here and to be able to experience their own ways of life and to flourish according to their own traditions, but we should establish a kind of culture in the United States in which we not just tolerate these differences, but we try to become open to them. Meaning that we don't simply say, well, you know, you can do whatever you like, but I think it's wrong. Instead, through our educational practices and our social interactions, we develop attempts to try to learn from one another. And in fact, one of the figures that I look at, W.E.B. Du Bois, who just celebrated his 107th anniversary recently, appropriate still for Black History Month. Du Bois says, look, the best things in American democracy came not from those original white men who established this country. The best of American society, the idea that American democracy is here for all people, that all people are created equal, that's not really what the Founding Fathers believed. That only became a widespread idea because black folks struggled mightily to be recognized as human beings and as a part of this society as well. They came along early on and said, these black lives matter, and these black lives are important for the purposes of making this democracy stronger and on a firmer basis, a moral one that recognizes that human beings are, in fact, all equal and are not based on a hierarchy of race. W.E.B. Du Bois says, this is the social gift that black folk gave to American democracy, and that maybe we should listen to our other immigrant communities to see what gifts they have to offer. In the final part of the book, what I look at is I look at the work of Cesar Chavez, who is a figure that I wrote my first book on, about nonviolence. And Cesar Chavez, writing in the 1980s, agreed with this kind of view that immigrants and people of color should be allowed to have their cultural and differences of various sorts, but we should learn how to listen to these different voices in ways that could change how we practice democracy itself. And I'll just leave with this kind of tidbit. One of the things that he argued is if we take seriously what the founding values of this country were, an appreciation of free speech and differences, the conclusion that Cesar Chavez says is that even undocumented immigrants, people who have come here illegally or who have stayed here illegally, in his view, after a certain time period here, have a moral right to stay, and even much more strongly than that. If we take seriously the values of democracy, the idea that power should be shared in a society such that if there's a decision that affects your life, you ought to have a say in that decision, then that means that even undocumented immigrants might have a right to vote in the United States. This is a really contentious issue where we are today. The reality is that undocumented immigrants or people who have not been here legally in some form or another have always been able to vote. And even still today, there are some municipalities, for instance, Tacoma Park, Maryland, that allows undocumented family members to vote in school board elections and local city elections under this democratic principle that if you are affected by a decision, you should have a right to have a say in it. And if those families have children in the public schools, which is allowed by the Supreme Court decision of Plyler v. Doe from 1982, then those parents should have a right to have a say in the curriculum that your children experience. San Francisco, I know, was working with a ballot measure to do a very similar thing to this, to give undocumented immigrants various kinds of limited voting rights, to have a say. So these are all sort of different kinds of experiments in trying to figure out, what does our democracy mean? What are the values of our democracy? This group of philosophers, I think, has a lot to teach us today. Primarily because their foes, the people that they were trying to argue against, were people like Madison Graham. Our task today, I think, is to try to listen to some of these voices because our highest authorities seem to want to return us to immigration priorities and to a vision of American society that was very popular in 1916. We've changed a lot since that point. It's very hard to imagine how we can make America great by going back to some kind of vision like that. But perhaps we can think about how to move forward and listen to voices that say that we have a lot to learn from the Mexican, from the Muslim, from the African, from the El Salvadoran, from the Haitian immigrant communities that live amongst us. And instead of trying to figure out how to wall them out, we should be trying to listen to how to be open to them for the lessons about how to make our democracy stronger. Thank you. Yeah, so Brexit, right, is the move by the UK to wall itself off in some sense, or pull itself out from the European Union. There's a lot of complicated issues involved in what's going on there. I wouldn't say it's entirely immigration issues, even though immigration issues play a part in what led to the decision about Brexit. But I think that some of the fears that perhaps help fuel the vote of citizens to think about leaving the European Union have to do with fears about what a different kind of European demographic might mean. And I think that this is a fear that's widespread in a lot of European nations, that's similar to what's going on here in the United States with the fear of Mexicans